and welcome to our Women's Walk with Christ vlog, Speaking Life. I'm Margaret Helton, and this is my co-host, Kim Turner.
Welcome to our December vlogs. I think if you watched the vlog from last time, you saw that Margaret and I are going to be recording an episode a week in December. It'll be a little bit different than what we've been doing, but still some of the same segments. But we're going to add a little bit of a Christmas theme to it and just get us all the way through December 24th. I think will be our last show with a special surprise on that day. So Margaret is going to give us a little introduction of our special guest today.
Yes. So our special guest today is Ms. Jean Simmons, and she's going to share something very special with us today. So with the beauty of this kind of technology, I encourage you to press the pause button so that you're totally ready and to get a nice hot cup of hot cocoa or coffee or whatever it is that you like to drink, so that you can be ready for Jean's special gift that she has to offer to us today. And I will let Kim talk a little bit more about our Jean.
So I think most of you, I hope, have had a chance to staff with Jean or at least run into her at some Women's Walk events. She has been given the name Ambassador of Peace for many, many reasons. She just exudes peace. I am blessed to have her in my spirit circle, and I get to share a lot of time with her. She is also one of our favorite concert buddies.
Yes.
And tonight, she is going to share the most beautiful story about Joseph that I get to hear every year at our spirit circle, and I know you all will join us, enjoy it just like we do. And here she is, Jean. And she's coming to us live from the Sea of Galilee. Just look at her.
Yes, she is.
Hello,
that's
Jean Simmons.
Big time.
Good evening, Kim Turner. And good evening, Margaret Helton.
Good evening, Jean Simmons.
I miss going to a concert.
Same.
Me too. I haven't gotten my groove on in a while.
I think it's been over a year now since our last concert, which is just too long.
Oh my gosh.
So I gave a brief introduction. So why don't you give us about when was your first weekend and your mission statement?
February 9th, 2007.
Wow.
2007.
It was founded the Franciscan Center. Mm-hmm. Oh, I love my mission statement. As an accepted woman walking with Christ, I co-create a peaceful and authentic world of abundance by embracing myself and others with joy, compassion, and forgiveness.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you do.
Very good.
Yep.
So I've heard a lot about this story that you're going to share with us. We'll do that first, and then we'll ask you a couple of special holiday edition questions. But I've heard a little bit from Kim about this story. So if you want to give any introduction, or if you don't, if you just want to start reading it, it's totally up to you. We can't wait to hear it.
Well, there is a special introduction in the back. You know, and that might be interesting. The nativity story tells us what Mary felt, but only what Joseph dreamed. It tells us Mary's thoughts on receiving gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, not what Joseph felt at receiving the gift of a stepson. His is a strange half-glimpsed story. Never in his life did Joseph have to grapple with the difficult notion of the Trinity, of God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit being three in one. Joseph was already dead when 30 years later, Jesus spoke the amazing secret out loud. I and the Father are one. But how, after such an extraordinary beginning, could Joseph not have realized that the boy in his care was in some way divine? That was the thought which gave rise to this book, that one night, and on many more, I dare say, Joseph the carpenter must have held his God in the crook of his arm and sung him to sleep.
Hmm. Okay. You know, there's not a lot of stories about Joseph.
Not at all. Not anything. Just some imaginings.
Yeah. This is a story.
This is the story. Father and Son, a Nativity Story by Geraldine Bakarian. Illustrations by Fabian Negrin. And it's published by Hyperion Books for Children. Sorry. Okay. After the star had set, after the angels had roosted, after the shepherds had hurried back to their sheep, there was one person still awake in the dark stable. Joseph sat watching the baby asleep in a manger of straw. "Mine, not mine," he whispered. "How am I supposed to stand in for your real father? How is a simple man like me to bring up the Son of God?" Mm-hmm. Not a good start. I could not even find him a proper place to be born, a proper bed to sleep in. He who has cradled us all in his hands since the start of time. What lullabies should I sing to someone who taught the angels to dance and peppered the sky with songbirds? How can I teach him his words and letters, he who strung the alphabet together? He who whispered dreams into a million, million ears in a thousand different languages? The very thought of it leaves me speechless. How can I teach him the scriptures? It will be like reading him a book he wrote himself. What stories can I tell him? He wrote the whole history of the world. What jokes? He knows them all. Didn't he invent the hilarious hippopotamus and make the rivers gurgle with laughter? Didn't he form the first face, wink, and make it smile? Come on. Someone tell me, how do I protect a child whose arm brandished the first bolt of lightning, who lobbed the first thunderclap, who wears sunlight for armor and a helmet of stars? And yet, somehow my heart quakes for you, child, small as you are. How shall I teach you right and wrong when it was you who drew up the rules, you who parted good from bad? How? And when I get angry and lose my temper, who will be to blame? Always me, I suppose. Oh. How do I feed and clothe someone who seeded the oceans with fish and hung up fruit in the trees, who shod the camels and crowned the deer? It's bread and fishes from now on, son, and clothes no better than mine. What games shall we play, boy, you and I? I mean, how can I rough and tumble with someone who pinned the ocean in place with a single tack-headed moon? And how shall I ever astound you, child, as my father did? You are the one who fitted the chicken into the egg and the oak tree into an acorn. How can I put a roof over your head knowing it was you who glass-roofed the world and thatched the sky with clouds and stitched the snow with threads of melting silver? I'm a carpenter, child. By rights, you should learn my trade. But how can I teach you to plane a door, knowing it was you who planed the planes who carved the valleys and hewed the hills, the wind in your one hand and the rain in the other. How? What presence can I offer you who has already given me everything? This wife, this night, this happiness, this son. What shall I pass down to you, little one, apart from a world of love? Not as much as the color of my eyes, not even my name. And yet, I've been thinking, child. My hands are strong, God knows, and everyone needs an extra pair of hands from time to time. So that's what I'll give you, son. That's what I'll be, God willing, a helping hand. So, long after the star had set, after the angels had roosted, after the shepherds had hurried back to their sheep, there was one person still awake in the dark stable, watching over a sleeping child. While his God watched over him. The end.
Yay. I love that story.
I do too. It makes me cry in so many places.
And you do, you have to wonder, what can you give Jesus who has everything, that made everything?
Made everything.
You know?
He lobbed the first thunderbolt. That's, I love that song by Chris Tomlin. You are amazing, God. Indescribable.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing that.
That's a very special story. Thank you.
My pleasure.
So now it's time for our
fa-la-la-la's. That's the special holiday edition of our fa-fa-fa-fuzz, the fa-la-la-la-la fa-fa-fa-fuzz.
Oh, sweet. That's very sweet.
See, we just wing it. We just come up with stuff, Gene.
Comes to us in the middle of the night.
It's the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit.
So based off the story you just read us, one of our holiday questions, Christmas questions is, if you were traveling to see baby Jesus for the first time, what gift would you take him?
A golden retriever puppy.
Jesus would like that. I don't know if Mary would have liked that, but why would you give him a puppy?
Because they're so small and tiny, and like he would be small and tiny, and they need a puppy to raise them right, you know. And he could snuggle with the baby Jesus.
Aww.
That's a good gift, Jean. I think baby Jesus would like that.
Did you all see that movie, The Star? It's an animation movie
called The Star. No, but I remember when you went to see it in the theater and you told me about it. Didn't you see it twice?
And I bought it.
I need to see.
There's a donkey named Bo in the movie. Oh. And it's the donkey that carried Mary into Bethlehem. Yeah.
Really? The Star?
Yes.
Okay. That leads us into our next question. Is that your favorite Christmas movie?
Yes, that is.
Do you have a favorite Christmas song?
A Little Drummer Boy.
Mm. Have you seen the video with King and Country when they sing it?
No, but I know The Chosen, Dallas Jenkins has it, and I know I gotta see it.
Oh my gosh, it is phenomenal.
They performed it live before, and it's just so good.
Well, I think that must be what I watched, the recording of the live. It was amazing.
So I think I could get it, or maybe on YouTube, I think.
Yeah. You can find it. They're fantastic. Did you go to that concert with us, King and Country?
Oh. Mm-hmm. So good.
So good.
Did they? I can't remember the other songs.
Oh, they have a lot of really good songs.
They do.
Okay, our next Christmas question is, if Christmas had a smell, what would it be?
Party mix. Yes, so my mom always made it every year, and oh, I loved it. Oh, I loved it, loved it, loved it. And the first year when I had been away from home for many months, I was away at school, and I didn't go home for Thanksgiving, so I didn't see them until Christmas. When I walked in the door, this whole party mix rolled over me. Oh, gosh, it smelled so good and so like home and so like Christmas. Yeah. And I made it for many years. Mom said mine was better than hers, but hers was better than mine. But I don't make it anymore because I just can't handle it.
Oh, anyway. Does it have gluten in it?
Well, I can do it gluten-free, but it's the nuts. I can't do the nuts. Yeah, so.
But the smell is still Christmas.
Yes. Yes, it is. It's still Christmas. Oh, gosh. I can remember.
They need to make a candle of it. They need to at least have a
candle. There you go.
Note forget cranberry. Forget pine.
We need a Czech party mix candle.
Write that down.
I am.
You heard it here first. When you see it on the shelf, it was Jean Simmons' idea, folks.
I'm going to call it the Jean Simmons Party Czech Mix Candle.
I don't think you can call it Czech Mix.
Oh, Jean Simmons party Christmas mix.
We can go party mix. We could go party.
Ooh, party's good.
Yes. Okay.
Okay. Margaret?
So, what is your favorite, ornament on the tree or decoration this time of year?
So, I've got them all boxes here. I haven't gone through them yet, but I do have violins, little violins. You've seen them in the stores. And I have all kinds of colors and, yeah, it's the violin.
Do you play the violin?
No, but Bo played the violin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you put your tree up yet?
No.
First of all, no. No.
Maybe. I love Advent. I really love Advent. Oh. I like this waiting time. I'll put the tree up though, but I won't turn the lights on. I just, you know, maybe next week I'll put the tree up. It'll be where it's supposed to be, but it won't have any decorations. And I won't turn the lights on until whenever Advent's done. I don't know when it's done. When is it? It's done the 20th.
Is that what you do every year? You just, you don't wait, you don't decorate it until then?
Yeah, exactly. Well, so, yeah, if I put one up at all.
You will.
But you will this year. After 2020.
I was moving last year, so I said forget it. I moved in the day after Christmas, so yeah.
So was that something you did as a tradition in your family before? Like you wouldn't decorate?
But we wouldn't, like some people put their Christmas tree up the day before Thanksgiving. Ooh, do you, Margaret?
I did this year just because I had time and I was off all last week. And so I did, but I usually don't. I usually do it after Thanksgiving.
Well, we would probably do it. We'd put our growing up, our tree up the week, maybe around the the 15th, maybe. Yeah, 15th. How about you guys? When would you put your tree up, Kim?
We always put ours up the day after Thanksgiving. And we used to, like my sister and I, we would get it decorated and we'd be over there, you know, all the icicles, tossing them everywhere. Right. And miraculously, we would wake up in the morning and it would be completely different than the way we decorated. So the fairy who lived in our house did not like our decorations. Oh, and so dear. Each icicle was meticulously hung on each branch.
Right. Right. And you would say to your mom, how do you like it, Mom? And she'd go, oh, yes, it's lovely.
It would always, yeah, be one of these, oh, it's so nice.
Bless your heart. It's so nice.
The icicles were so boring. After a while, you just get so tired. I just would want it up and throw it on.
That was the best part of it, that little icicles. You could just throw them and they'd be all over the place. Somebody didn't like it.
I know. My mom would say, put it on nicely.
Mm-hmm. Yep. What's Christmas without an icicle war? I mean, really.
Yes.
Had two trees. We had like a kid tree, and then my mom had her like really nice, perfect angel tree where all the ornaments were just angels. But then on the kid tree that was in the basement, we put all of our funky, crazy ornaments and our crazy lights, and that one could look like whatever we wanted to.
And it's the ones
it was
you
in
made.
The basement.
It was in the basement, so she didn't keep it upstairs for anyone to see but us.
But did you made some of the ornaments at school?
Mm-hmm. Those are on the basement tree. Wah, wah.
Does she still do that? Two trees?
No, she only does one tree now.
Does one. A perfect angel tree.
Yep.
I would have to switch out the colored lights. This was with my husband, Herb and Bo. One year we'd have colored lights. And one year we'd have the white lights.
Mm-hmm.
And the white lights only had white ornaments or gold ornaments. You know, it was all just really elegant.
Wow.
The colored lights had all this crap on it.
The crap is the best part. There's some fun stuff.
It is fun. Yeah, it is fun.
So what are your plans for Christmas this year?
Well, I just spent the Thanksgiving, the day before Thanksgiving, through my birthday. Well, I had Friday. I came home Friday. When was my birthday? Anyway, at my brother's house. His family self-quarantines. So they pick up their food at the store. They don't go to Costco. They don't go be with their friends. So that's what I did. And they wear those KN95 face masks. And they gave me one. So that's what I wear when I'm in quarantine. And I got to be there. And we didn't have to wear masks. We didn't have to be 6 feet away. We got hugs.
Oh.
I had at least two kids on my lap a lot, and I could hug them and tell them I loved them. It was amazing. It was like normal. There was a piece of normal heaven in my life. So I'm going to do that again. I go back in. I'm in quarantine now. I'll have, I think, 4 days next week out, but then I'll go back into quarantine, and then I'll be good for Christmas, and I'll go spend Christmas Eve at my brother's house, and then I'll be there Christmas morning, and they'll have their Christmas in the morning and then come over, and maybe they'll stay over Christmas night, because everybody stayed over Thanksgiving night and it was my brother's daughter Caitlin and his son Mark Jr. He's married to Hannah, and they have a little girl, Charlotte, who I finally got to know. Caitlin and Colin have two children, Olivia and Avery.
Oh.
And so they stayed over.
Wow.
Yeah, and then all of us. There's still another son up in Fort Collins, but they don't self-quarantine. So, yeah.
Oh, that'll be nice.
That'll be good.
Yeah. I'm glad you got to hug some people.
I know it. People don't realize, maybe they do. I don't know how we're getting through this whole thing without, because I always hugged everybody.
Right.
Everybody, whether they were a hugger or not. Because I needed them.
I have a hard time at work because that's my nature. Like, I just hug people. My work, it's not quite as acceptable to hug people. But it's like a habit, you know, that's how you welcome people. And so it has been.
It's been hard for sure.
It has. I just get to hug Glenn a lot and DJ a lot.
that's nice. That's
yeah. They might be tired of it.
It's your own mental health. And theirs.
Yeah. Makes you feel better, right?
Warm hugs.
Yeah.
I think you said a couple of weeks ago, like, you're tired of hugging yourself.
And I'm tired of looking at myself all the time.
All right, we got off track. So our last Christmas question for you, Jean, is what is your favorite Christmas cookie, dessert, or holiday treat?
Party mix.
Party mix again?
This is easy. I said party mix to about four of them.
Even though you can't eat it anymore, is there anything you can eat this year that's your favorite?
No. I can't eat any pies. I can't eat the cookies. I can't eat. But, oh, you know what I'm going to do? There's a dream cake my mother made. It was angel food. I think I've made it for you guys.
Mm-hmm.
Angel food with, what are those called?
Lady fingers,
yes, around. It's very beautiful. And, the frosting is... I'm going to make it with real whipped cream and marshmallow fluff. And it really frosts good. So I always make more frosting. And then I always buy an extra package of ladyfingers. Well, that's all right. And I put the frosting in little sandwiches. Big deal. I'm getting these cookies. Coconut cookies. You can get them at Sprouts. They're vanilla or chocolate. They look like they rolled up. You know those rolled up cookies? They're Italian.
Yeah.
Kind of like that. Yeah. And I'm going to stuff them with that frosting. And that's what I can have. And they're all going to want it too, so I'll bring enough for everybody.
Send us a picture when you make it. That looks and sounds beautiful.
I'd love to.
It's very light. It's a beautiful, but the angel food and it's just so light. It's a beautiful dessert.
That's why it's called dream cake.
I thought you might mention, or maybe that's just me, but the tutke. Don't you guys eat tutke? Or
yes.
You used to?
Well, yeah. Like, used to, like, 10 years ago. But Donna, my brother's wife, she makes it. But he's vegetarian now, so he won't eat it. Who else?
This cake has meat in it?
It is a minced meat? Is that what it is?
No. It's pork. It's just pork.
Oh.
Ground pork with potatoes and onions. And you cook it up. And you put it in a pie shell. And then put a top shell on. I think that's all you put in it, really, salt and pepper. But My gosh, it's good. What?
Doesn't it have like oregano or something in it? No?
No. Why would you do that?
I don't know. I feel like there's a spice in it that my mom always puts in it, but I don't know what it is.
Well, your mom might make it a little different than my mom made it.
Okay.
And there is always a fight, an argument in my father's town where he grew up, Queechy, Vermont. And there are other French Canadians in the town, and they would make it with raisins.
Ew, no.
No and fruit in desserts. That's my rule.
No fruit in food.
No fruit in food.
I don't know where the raisins came from at all. But, you know, when you find out these different, oh, no, I never would put that in my took here.
Never in all my days.
Right. That's not real took here.
How do you say it? How do you say it?
Took here.
Okay. We just call it tutke.
Tutke.
Yeah. We probably
white. You were saying tut cake.
No, tutke is how we put. I think Jean probably says it the right way.
But it sounds like turkey, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And it's really pork.
Does it mean something in Spanish?
It's French.
It's French.
Oh.
My mom is French.
Yes, she is. Oh. She's French Canadian.
Yes, she is.
Well, so does it mean something in French?
Probably.
Well, it's
probably means pork pie. It just sounds fancier. Well, it's touch cake.
Oh, darling.
Nope, it's pork and potatoes.
American selling butchering the French language.
Well, you know how every culture has a meal after midnight mass, going to church on Christmas Eve, and mm-hmm. you'd come home and you would have fasted the whole day. You wouldn't have had anything to eat. So the Scandinavian, you know, they had this great big seven fish kind of meal, a great big spread. The Hispanics, they do have a bunch of food to eat too, and this is what the French
always eat.
Yes.
Did you eat yours on Christmas Eve?
Yes. And we put it in, they'd be frozen. We put it in the oven, go to church, and when we came home, that was another lovely aroma that would come wafting when you open up the door. Oh.
That's so when I always knew, oh yes, the Santa Claus is coming. We have to pay. It's time.
It was so cute. My nephew and my niece, they told me, great Olivia and Avery told me what they put on their list for Santa. And I could feel them so excited that they were going to get this special, you know, remember? Special
yes.
toy. And this one toy that Avery wanted, it's a dispenser of candy, whatever, I don't know. And I said, well, you're going to have to ask your mom, you know, when you can have it. And he went, no, it's going to be in my room. I can have it anytime I want it. Oh, gosh.
And if it's from Santa, hello.
Absolutely.
It's allowed.
It's sacred. Yes.
Mom can't say anything. Santa trumps mom. Sorry.
Yes.
Thankfully, my kids did not know that. Well, Jean, thank you so much for coming on and sharing your story and your holiday traditions and favorite things. We really appreciate it.
Oh, I loved it. Thank you. I started answering the questions this morning. I think that was pretty good. I was really excited about it. And you brought back so many wonderful memories. So I love that. I appreciate that so much.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you for sharing your memories. And Merry Christmas to you, my genie.
Merry Christmas to you, Margaret Hilton.
Merry Christmas, Jean Simmons.
Merry Christmas, Kip Turner. I don't like to do that.
We do it for you.
I know you do.
I love you, and I hope you have a wonderful Christmas.
I love you both.
Bless you.
Hi, Jean.
I love you. I love you.
Oh, Jean. That was very special to reminisce with her.
I see her, but I miss her. You know, like I see her twice a month at Spirit Circle, but it's just not the same.
She has a very calming presence about her that you could probably hear through the book that she read, but she's a very special lady.
She is, and I'm glad she got to share that. I wish she could have been able to turn it so you could see the pictures. It's so beautifully illustrated.
So now we still want to incorporate the verse into our show during our holiday editions. And we also would like to share a Christmas recipe with you. So first the verse. This week we are going to read a verse out of Luke chapter 2, starting in verse 8. And I'm going to read it out of the NIV version, and then Kim has a different version. So in Luke chapter 2, verse 8, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people."
So mine is Luke chapter 2, verse 8, and it's from the Message. And it says, "There were shepherds camping in the neighborhood. They had set night watches over their sheep. Suddenly, God's angel stood among them, and God's glory blazed all around them. They were terrified. The angel said, 'Don't be afraid. I'm here to announce a great and joyful event that is meant for everybody worldwide.'"
I like that your version says camping.
And how perfect for right now. So many people are camping. I don't know if everybody in your towns are camping, but we have a lot of people camping on the streets.
There's a lot of campers.
Maybe they're the shepherds. We don't know.
Hopefully not tonight, though. I think it's going to be like 17 and snowing.
Freeze. But they do. And they're protected somehow. I don't know. But
so each week this month, we will share different verses from the Christmas story for you to enjoy. And now we will talk to you about our recipe.
Yay. So if you remember, a while back we had people submit recipes for our fundraising committee. We're going to release a Women's Walk with Christ cookbook, and we'd hoped to have done it before for Christmas, but we all know what's going on in the world. And so we hope to have it out the first part of 2021. And so during these episodes, we're going to share one holiday recipe that was submitted to us during that time. And this also came to us from a suggestion from someone that watches our blog. That thought that would be fun to share those recipes that we got. So this week, Margaret is going to share one that she submitted.
So these are called Easy Oreo Truffles, and I make this every year. My husband loves Oreo cookies, so I make these with double stuffed Oreos, but I think you could make it with any kind of Oreo, and you could really get creative if you wanted to use like a special, I think they have like flavored ones now, like peppermint and different flavored Oreos. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, they have so many flavors.
So pick your favorite flavor. I make them with double stuffed Oreos, just regular. So it's one package of those, and then it's one package of cream cheese, like a block of the cream cheese. And it's Christmas, so don't get the third less fat. Get the full fat one. because it's worth it. It's better with full fat cream cheese.
You already have double stuffed Oreos. Do you need some fatty cheese?
Yeah, no need to skimp on the cheese when you start with the Oreos as a base. And then you also need two packages of Baker's semi-sweet baking chocolates that you melt. And so what you do is you take the Oreos and you kind of, I use my potato masher and I mash them up in a bowl so that they're kind of just chunks of Oreo cookie. And then you mix in the cream cheese and then you make these little balls and then you roll them in the melted chocolate that I just melted in the microwave. And then you roll them so that they're covered in chocolate. And then I put them in the freezer for like an hour. And then if you wanted to sprinkle on a little bit of like candy cane on the top to make it really festive, or I've seen people put like little peanut butter, like a Reese's Pieces, like crunch on the top or something like that. And it's super delish. And it's just a fun little easy Christmas treat. And it's my my husband's favorite Christmas treat. So
yeah. So you don't grind them till they're like fine. You keep it kind of chunky, the Oreo.
Yeah, you keep it kind of chunky because then when you bite into it, you have like the chunks of the Oreo cookie.
Yum.
Yeah.
That sounds super easy.
Yeah, super easy and super good. And only three ingredients. So it's something you can grab really quick and make really quick. So
wow. Well, thank you for sharing that.
Absolutely.
So now once our cookbook releases, you'll have to look for that delicious Oreo cookie recipe by Margaret. So I think that's it for our Christmas show.
Yeah, that's all we have for you today. But like we said in the newsletter, and like we already said at the beginning, we're coming at you every week this month of December with different special holiday guests and holiday treats and holiday verses. So
please tune in and we'll have something special every week. We have different guests already lined out and we're hoping to keep them a little bit shorter just because they'll be every week, but we truly appreciate everybody that's taken the time to watch each one. And we hope that we've given you a little bit of fun and la, 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 la in your day. We enjoy it and we hope that you do too.
So we will see you next week for another special holiday edition. Until then, may you be merry and bright.
Bless you. Have a good night.
Bless you.